Jesus. will I fulfil my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. They who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. And those who cannot keep themselves alive, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn. For he has done it. And our second reading is from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Jesus predicts his death. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and he rebuked him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Before I begin, a short prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the words that you have given me to speak this morning. I pray that those listening will hear and understand the message of your holy word. In your name we pray. Amen. Whereas Matthew's Gospel may be seen as formal and stately, Mark's Gospel, on the other hand, is bustling with life. Matthew collects Jesus' sayings. Mark concentrates on the marvellous things that he did and the places he went to. Mark takes time to explain Jewish customs. So he obviously had non-Jewish readers in mind. It is the shortest gospel, written about AD 65 to 70, or perhaps even earlier than that. Most of what Mark writes can be found in either the Gospels of Matthew or Luke, or both. There is very little of the writing that is unique to Mark, but in Mark's Gospel we see Jesus in action, and as we read and understand, we can be convinced that he is indeed the Son of God himself. After Jesus had spent some time in the wilderness and had been tempted by Satan, who had failed to make him fall, we are told that Jesus went on to call his disciples, many of them fishermen, to follow him. We assume that they were men of great faith from the first, when they first met Jesus. But they had to grow in faith, just as all believers do. Although it took time for Jesus' message to get through, the disciples followed. In the same way, we may question and falter, but we must never stop following Jesus. Jesus needed the disciples to spread the gospel so that people would be lifted out from darkness into the light, and so their lives would be transformed. We too need to cast our nets and help in the mission to transform the lives of people. The gospel needs to reach out to everyone. And like the disciples, we should not delay our response to Jesus calling us and asking us to go tell. We are only halfway through Mark's gospel when Jesus begins to speak about his death. He has been travelling around the towns performing miracles and teaching the people. He had fed the 4,000 with 7 loaves and a few fish. He had healed many, including the blind man at Bethsaida. When they reached the villages about Caesarea Philippi, we read in the verses just before our reading that Jesus began asking his disciples, "Who do people say I am?" And the disciples replied, "John the Baptist, Elijah, or one of the other prophets." And then Jesus asked them, who do you say I am?" That's when Peter answered, "You're the Messiah." What Peter says is important, because it is not enough to know what others say about Jesus. You must know and accept for yourself that he is the Messiah. Jesus asked his disciples to keep it a secret. Now that begs a question. Why would he want it to be kept a secret? Why? Because the people were expecting a political leader. News of Jesus' amazing powers, which marked him out as the Messiah, could easily have sparked off a rising against the Roman occupation. It was imperative that the miracles should be accompanied by teaching to explain the kind of kingdom Jesus had come to establish, and also what the Messiah's real mission was. Verse 31 says, "The Son of Man must suffer many things." This was the necessary work of the Messiah, and it was predicted in passages like Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 to 12. He must die. He must, after his death, rise again. The suffering and death of Jesus was a must because of two great facts: people's sin and God's love. While his death was the ultimate example of people's sin against God, it was also the supreme expression of God's love to humanity. The Messiah suffered for our sakes, bearing our sins to make us acceptable to God. What can we say to such love? How will we respond to him? We cannot be made right with God by our own works. We can only be made right with God because of the Messiah's great work on the cross. For as Paul writes in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. When we trust in Christ, we make an exchange, our sin for his righteousness. Our sin was laid on Christ at his crucifixion. His righteousness is given to us at our conversion. We should all be grateful for his kindness towards each one of us. Peter, however, took him aside and began to rebuke him. Peter's intent was love for Jesus, but he was unconsciously used by Satan. You don't have to be demon-possessed for Satan to use you. And we need to be on guard in case we are unconsciously used too. In this moment, Peter was not considering God's purposes, but only his own natural human desires and feelings. Peter wanted Christ to be king, not the suffering servant prophesied in Isaiah chapter 53. He was ready to receive the glory of following the Messiah, but not the persecution. Peter is a perfect example of how a sincere heart, coupled with a man's thinking, can often lead to disaster. The Christian life is not easy. It often involves hard work, persecution, deprivation, and deep suffering. It's not paved with wealth either. Peter saw only part of the picture. We should make every effort not to make the same mistake. Instead, we need to focus on the good that God can bring out of apparent evil and the resurrection that follows the crucifixion. Jesus says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." This was a strong rebuke from Jesus, yet entirely appropriate. Jesus knew there was a satanic purpose in discouraging him from his ministry on the cross, and Jesus would not allow that purpose to succeed. Peter will eventually become the rock on which the church is built, and it will be Peter, a natural spokesman, who will be responsible more than any other for the formation of the church at Pentecost. But that is another story we will hear about later in the year. Jesus needs to prepare his disciples for the suffering that lies ahead. He calls the crowd to him and his disciples, and in verse 34 he says, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." It's bad enough for the disciples to hear that Jesus would suffer, be rejected and die on a cross. Now Jesus told them that they had to do the same thing. Deny themselves and take up their cross. Everybody knew what Jesus meant when he said this. The Romans, who were Mark's original audience, knew what taking up the cross meant. Everyone knew that the cross was an unrelenting instrument of death that was used mainly for dangerous criminals. The cross had no other purpose. Denying self means you're living in a world where your primary focus is based upon other people. Jesus was the only person to do this perfectly, but we are to follow in his steps. Take up their cross and follow me. This is following Jesus at its simplest. He carried a cross and walked to the place of execution. So must those who follow him. We deny self when we surrender ourselves to Christ and determine to obey his will. The commentator Wessel writes, "Cross-bearing does not refer to some irritation in life. You've heard it said, haven't you? It's my cross to bear. It may be some mundane task that people are expected to do. Or it might even be that they have to look after someone continuously because they love that person. But they consider it their cross to bear. And it's nothing in relation to what Jesus went through and what he asked us to go through. Cross-bearing involves the way of the cross. The picture is of a man already condemned, required to carry his cross on the way to the place of execution, as Jesus was required to do. The cross is also a symbol of shame and humiliation, which the Christian must be prepared to endure for the sake of Christ. Jesus warns the disciples that their idea of what is shameful and what is honourable is completely confused. They cannot share the glory of the Son of Man from Daniel chapter 7 if they reject the suffering servant of Isaiah chapter 52 verse 13 to 53 verse 12. But they will understand eventually. Although after the crucifixion they will hide in fear, as we read in John chapter 20 verse 19, soon they will greet prison and beatings with joy as a sign they are worthy to suffer for their Saviour. Acts chapter 5, verses 40 to 41. We live in times when believers are ridiculed, just as others before us have been. In some places, Christians are openly persecuted. Their property is confiscated and they suffer violent attacks. In such times as these, it is easy to be a closet Christian. In other words, it's easy to just stay in and not say anything about Jesus Christ. How can we not go out and do that? How can we never show others as believers or stand up for our Lord? How can we not do that? Jesus wants us to do more than just hold on to the truth. He wants us to share it. The Christian life is hard work. It requires us to give up whatever endangers our relationship with God, to run with endurance and to struggle against sin with the power of the Holy Spirit. To live effectively, we must keep our eyes upon Jesus. We have to focus on him and not ourselves and our own circumstances. And we must always keep him in sight. Jesus says, whoever loses their life for me and for the Gospels will save it. We must follow Jesus this way because it is the only way that we will ever find life. It sounds strange to say you will never live until you carry your cross as Jesus did, but that is the idea. You can't gain resurrection life without dying to your old self first. I think Garth mentioned this just the other week. You don't lose a seed when you plant it, though it seems dead and buried. Instead, you set the seed free to be what it was always intended to be. To grow, to give fruit, to be of use. That's what Jesus wants us to do. Avoiding carrying our cross with Jesus means that we make gain the whole world, and in so doing, end up losing everything that has been promised to us. Jesus himself had the opportunity to gain the world by worshipping Satan. Read Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 8 to find out the temptations Jesus faced. But he found life and victory in obedience instead. Many people spend all their energy seeking pleasure. But Jesus warns us that worldliness, which is centered on possessions, position, or power, is ultimately worthless. Whatever you have on earth is only temporary. It cannot be exchanged for your soul. You may acquire all you want, but ultimately your life will be hollow and empty because you will always want more to try and make yourself happy. Amazingly, the people who live a life of obedience before Jesus are the ones who are really, genuinely happy. Giving our life to Jesus all the way and living as others-centered person does not take away from our life, it adds to it. Jesus is coming again in his Father's glory. And if we will rebel against the world, the flesh, and the devil, we will share in the glory. Amen. Let us pray. God of compassion, the way of the cross is as much a mystery to us as it was to the immediate followers of Jesus. But we have heard how your grace is exercised in the journey of suffering and rejection experienced by Jesus. Help us to hear with ears inspired, to see with eyes open to your ways, and to respond with lives committed to your service. Amen. We're going to have another worship song now. My Hope Is Built.
My hope is built are nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord our own. When darkness seems to hide its face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ in His righteousness alone, thoughtless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in Savior's love, through the storm. Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Christ is indeed our cornerstone, And so we join together in our Christian belief, saying what we believe in. There is one God and Father, from him all things come. There is one Lord Jesus Christ, through him we come to God. There is one Holy Spirit, in him we are baptized into one body. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And now I invite Jenny to lead us in our intercessions.
The response to the bidding, in Christ, we or they can be dead to sin, is and alive to God. In Christ, we can be dead to sin and alive to God. So let us pray to our Heavenly Father, who is familiar with our world and understands our humanity and draws us here together in his love. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2 tells us to pray for all in authority so we may live quiet and peaceful lives. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for all the leaders in our country, in the government, in NHS, in education, commerce, and all the forces, wherever their silence allows injustice and corruption to flourish. We ask for truth, transparency, and godliness in their decisions and leading. We ask for deeper compassion, your wisdom and commitment. May they lead with integrity, humility, and a sense of right. May unjust practices be changed for good, and conflicts of great tension be peacefully resolved. Help them, O Lord, to uphold what is right and just, and establish a social order which is rooted in godly love. For in Christ they can be dead to sin and alive to God. Lord, we lift up all those whose bodies, minds, or spirits are riddled with pain, or they are too weak or exhausted. We ask the bathing love of your presence and the practical caring of hands working in your name. Give comfort, reassurance, healing, wholeness, and peace to all those whose lives are crippled or disadvantaged by illness, frailty, or damage. Remember all who need medical treatment or are waiting in pain for surgery. We pray for all who are ill at home or in hospitals, for those who have just discovered that they have injuries or illness that will change their lives and their families. In their shock, give them your grace to persevere with patience and turn these dark times into places of spiritual growth. In Christ, they can be healed in body and mind and be alive in God. Today, we particularly pray for the Duke of Edinburgh and anyone who's on your heart, in the silence of your heart. Call out their names, please. From Church of England's prayer diary, we've been asked to pray for Pershaw and Evesham Deanery, for Area Dean Sarah Dangerfield, for the Anglican Church in Central America, Bishop Julio Murray Thompson, in Canterbury, for Archbishop Justin Welby, with his team of bishops across the land. Bishop Rose Hudson, Wilkin of Dover, Bishop Rod Thomas of Maidstone, Bishop Norman Banks of Richborough, Bishop Jonathan Goodall of Ebbsfleet, Bishop David Maclay in the United Diocese of Down and Drogheda in Ireland. Father, we lift all these, your servants, and the areas they have the responsibility for. Fill them with your godly wisdom. Continue to guide them with your Holy Spirit. May their eyes of understanding be enlightened, so they'll know what is the hope of your calling. And may they never be sidetracked with things that are unessential to your purpose. Lift them up in times of discouragement. Lift their eyes above the circumstances around them and give them your perspective. May their decisions and direction be not in conflict with your holy will. Give them keen ears to your voice when they are surrounded by so many voices. Above all, we pray for your protection over each one of them and their families and the communities they serve. And at this time, we remember all our clergy in our parish, in our deanery, and in our diocese. In Christ, they can be dead to sin and alive to God. We place all our schools in your hands, O Heavenly Father, as they reopen in the new future, all the staff and children and their families in these uncertain days. Please protect them from all anxiety, fear, and illness. Give understanding to the teaching staff and administrators in all matters that lie before them. Give them grace and wisdom to faithfully discharge their duties, that in all things they may seek the true well-being of those who are in their care. In the silence of our hearts, let's remember all that we know personally. In Christ, they can be dead to sin and alive to God. Dear Heavenly Father, we call to mind all whom we have known and loved but can no longer see and find it hard to live without them or ache with sorrow at their going. Thank you for those whose living and dying has taught us much about your love. Thank you for them and their gift to us all in their acts of kindness and love. Freed from their affliction and pain, may they enjoy forever the life of heaven. Take from us all bitterness of heart, and let us share with them the peace you give, over which death has no power at all. Thank you for your overarching love and undergirding faithfulness to us. And thank you for your promise of eternal life and peace. May we comfort one another through your love. In the silence of our heart, let's remember all that we loved and we knew at this time. We pray for the dying and their loved ones who are anxious and afraid. Also those journeying through death, unknown and unnoticed, approaching death not knowing you, but reject what they imagine you to be. Have mercy on them. May they respond to the true and living God and know your love forever. For in Christ they can be dead to sin and alive in God. Now let us pray for ourselves. Lord, we want to pray for stronger faith and the courage to live up to our calling, for the grace to act always with the generosity of spirit that you show to us, until the whole church models the godly wisdom which the world counts as foolishness. Grant us your spirit of discernment, your understanding of unspoken needs, and your capacity for forgiveness. We pray that as Christians, may we listen more attentively and with great urgency than ever before to the words of Jesus. Give us more awareness of your presence with us, both in our worship and in our day-to-day life. Give us the courage to live out your truth with joy, wherever or whenever we are ridiculed or persecuted for our faith. We ask for your courage and inner strength. Wherever we are called to be your witnesses, we ask for the grace to communicate your love. Where our love for you has grown cold, we ask to fan the flames again. Lord, may you remain the focus of our love and worship. As you have rescued us, may we not return to the slavery of sin, but live in your freedom. For in Christ, we can be dead to sin and alive to God. Let's all pray together. Almighty God, you have promised to hear the prayers of those who speak your Son's name. We pray that we have asked faithfully, we may receive in full as promised. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And let us say the collect for today together, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion that they may reject those things that are contrary to their profession and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's join into the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We're going to sing again now. Dear Lord and Father of mankind,
forgive our foolish ways. Thank you, Pam. And as somebody's remarked, it was a truly powerful word this morning, so thank you very much. And I just want to say it's a privilege to be able to say that next Sunday we will be meeting again at 3 o'clock in the afternoon for public worship. As always, as previously, our practice is to continue to keep you safe. And in order to do that, we do need you to book in with our church warden, Linda Nicholas, either by phone or email, so that she knows you're coming and is able to make the proper arrangements. We will be following the practice of keeping distance, social distancing, sanitizing our hands, and wearing a face mask inside the building while we are here. And so next Sunday, and it will be a service of Holy Communion. For those who want to join us, please do let Linda know. The service online next Sunday morning at 10:30 will be as normal, but it will also be a communion service, so we'll be sharing together in that. Those in the building will be receiving communion, and you can join us in fellowship as we remember our Lord's death and his resurrection. The second thing that I wanted to say was that our Lent study is still continuing. There's still time if you want to join it. If for any reason you didn't get a link and you wanted to run this week, our apologies for that. We don't know why you didn't get one, but do contact either Linda or myself by email or telephone, and we will make sure that you do get a link for the service along with the material for this coming day. Back to you, Ben.
Thank you, Garth. We're coming towards the end of our service now, and thank you for joining us this morning. And I do hope you'll be able to join us for morning prayers at 10 o'clock during the week, and join with us again next week. We come to our going out prayers. God of our pilgrimage, you have led us to the living water. Refresh and sustain us as we go forward on our journey. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord God Almighty is our Father. He loves us and tenderly cares for us. The Lord Jesus Christ is our Saviour. He has redeemed us and will defend us to the end. The Lord, the Holy Spirit, is among us. He will lead us in God's holy way. To God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be praise and glory today and forever. Amen. And let us share together in the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.